Okay. Bien, entonces vamos a comenzar lección 3. So, let's see here. We're going to review, repaso. Vamos a repasar mis gustos y preferencias, las compras, las palabras masculinas y femeninas y los colores. New stuff, lo nuevo. We'll learn some more greetings and ways to say goodbye, saludos y despedidas. We'll learn how to use adjectives. And we'll talk about things in your opinion. All right, let's do a quick review of the introduction. So we can, let's go backwards this time. So let's start with Carly and go to Leia.
Hola, me llamo Carly. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Sí, por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Leia.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿De dónde eres?
Soy de Denver.
¿Dónde vives? Vives.
Vivo en Denver.
¿Dónde trabajas?
Trabajo en mi casa.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta la montaña. La montaña.
¿Te gusta? What was?
Caminar.
Me gusta caminar en la montaña. Good.
Me gusta caminar en la montaña.
Muy bien.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
303-910-5912.
Estamos en contacto.
Me pase bien.
Hasta luego.
Nos vemos.
Nice job. Okay, Leia to Sky.
Hola, me llamo Leia. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Sí, por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Sky.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿Dónde eres?
Soy de Nebraska.
¿Dónde vives?
Vivo en Denver.
¿Dónde trabaja?
Trabajo en Frederick.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta esquiar.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
Mi número de teléfono es 303-601-9901.
¿Estamos en contacto?
Me parece bien.
Hasta luego.
Nos vemos.
Okay, nice job. Ahora Sky, Carly.
Hola, me llamo Sky. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Sí, por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Carly.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿De dónde eres?
Soy de Oklahoma.
¿Dónde vives?
Vivo en Broomfield.
¿Dónde trabajas?
Trabajo en Boulder.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta yoga.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
Mi número de teléfono es 405-308-8445.
Estamos en contacto.
Me parece bien.
Hasta luego.
Nos vemos.
Muy bien. Just real quick, Carly, for me gusta yoga. So you could say me gusta el yoga. You should use the article there, el yoga. Mm-hmm. So this is not a Spanish word. Obviously, it's been incorporated, mm-hmm. I guess, from the Hindu language, Hindi or something like that. And so that's why we're going to use the masculine article there. Mm-hmm. You know, it ends with A, so you might think it's la yoga, but I do believe it would be el yoga. And then just to add a little more detail, so like if, you know, that's fine just to say me gusta el yoga, but if you want to like actually say I like to do yoga, mm-hmm. You could either add hacer or practicar. I might say okay. Me gusta practicar yoga.
Practicar yoga.
Mm-hmm. Muy bien. Okay, nice job, everybody. Great. All right, this will be a little bit of the Spanish pronunciation here. So remember these vowel sounds. Repeat after me. A.
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 E.
E.
I.
I.
O.
O.
U.
U.
Muy bien. The Y and the L in Spanish are going to essentially make the same sound. However, it's going to depend on exactly the region in the world. Normally, I teach this as kind of a Y sound because most people you're going to talk to here in Colorado are going to be from Mexico. And in Mexico, it's pronounced more like a Y. So this phrase here would sound like, yo me llamo Yolanda Villa. Lea, you're going to Spain with your Spanish, and they're going to pronounce this a little bit harsher, almost like a J, right? So it'd sound a little bit more like, yo me llamo Yolanda Villa in Spain, okay? Mm-hmm. Kind of a subtle J, but it's more of a J as opposed to a Y, if that makes sense. Okay, so repiten, cebolla.
Cebolla.
Caballero.
Caballero.
Botella.
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 Pollo.
Pollo.
Billete.
Billete.
Silla.
Silla.
Amarillo.
Amarillo.
Proyector.
Proyector.
Yo.
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 Yolanda.
Yolanda.
Playa.
Playa.
Ya.
Ya. Ya.
Mayo.
Mayo.
Rayo.
Rayo.
Yeah. Okay, here's a new greeting for you. Hola, ¿qué tal? Does anybody know what ¿qué tal means?
How are you?
Yeah, it's another way of saying how are you, how's it going, what's up. It's kind of a multi-use expression in Spanish, right? So if you get asked this when you're talking to somebody, very common ways to answer it would be to say todo bien, which is like saying it's all good, excelente, meaning everything's excellent, or tranquilo, which is kind of like how we'd say everything's cool or I'm just chilling, kind of something like that. So let's practice with this. Let's go Leia to Sky.
Hello, ¿qué tal?
Todo bien.
All right, Sky to Carly.
Hola, ¿qué tal?
Excelente. Hola, ¿qué tal?
Tranquilo.
Oh, yeah. Depending on the time of day, your greeting might be a little different. In the morning, it'd be common to say buenos dias. In the afternoon, you'd say buenas tardes. And at night, you can say buenas noches. A couple of things to point out here. Dia is masculine, even though it ends with A, and that's why we're saying buenos dias with an O on the end. La tarde and la noche are feminine words, and so we're changing it from bueno to buena, okay, with an A in there. Buenas noches, just so you know, is used to say good evening as a hello, and it can also be used as good night to say goodbye, if that makes sense. Adios. So, of course, this is the word everybody learns in like elementary school, how to say goodbye in Spanish, right? However, it's not very commonly used. Much in the same way, like in English, I feel like it's very rare that we actually say goodbye to somebody, right? It almost sounds like goodbye and good riddance, right? Like it's more of a, it kind of has a stronger intonation to it. It's not a rule that adios is like a permanent goodbye, but it could be understood that way sometimes. It's like, I'm not going to see you again, so adios, if that makes sense. It is much more common when you're saying goodbye to your friends or your family or whomever you're speaking with to say something like hasta mañana. And that's like saying until tomorrow or see you tomorrow. Nos vemos, see you later. Hasta luego. Again, until later, or see you later. Chao, and chao is more like saying bye, right? It's a simple bye. Now, chao, you're not gonna hear around here very much just because it is not used very much in Mexico. However, all over South America, and especially in Spain, you will hear chao. So, ¿qué dirías en estas situaciones? What would you say in these situations? Lea, you get to school at 10:30 a.m. and you see your classmates and your teacher.
Buenos días.
Sky, you're leaving work, but you'll see your colleagues tomorrow.
Hasta luego.
Yeah. Here directly, although hasta luego is 100% acceptable too, but just because of the word tomorrow that we're throwing in here, I would say hasta mañana.
Hasta mañana.
Carly, you're meeting friends for lunch at 1 p.m.
No sé, would this just be for the afternoon?
Yeah, good afternoon, exactly.
Okay. So, hasta luego?
So, hasta luego means goodbye.
Oh, goodbye.
Okay. But you're meeting them, right? So, you're greeting
them. Yes. So, no sé.
So, you want to say good afternoon. Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes. Lea, you're meeting friends for cocktails at 10 p.m.
Buenas noches.
Again. Now you're leaving the bar at 11 to go home, Sky.
Buenas noches.
Also buenas noches, muy bien. Carly, you just finished a semester abroad in Argentina and you're coming home to the United States.
Adios.
Muy bien, there's where adios might be a little bit more appropriate. Lea, class is over. You'll see your classmates next week.
Hasta luego.
Hasta luego. Yeah, any of these would work here. Nos vemos. Hasta luego. Ciao. All right. So, Sky, you're with your friends now, but you're going home. So you're saying goodbye to them. But you're just going home to get ready for a night out with them a little bit later in the day.
Hasta luego.
Perfecto. Okay. So now let's practice the introduction again. This time we're going to throw in the new expression, hola, ¿qué tal? Okay. So let's go Sky to Carly.
Hola, ¿qué tal?
Excelente.
Me llamo Sky. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Sí, supuesto.
Por supuesto.
Por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Carly.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿De dónde eres?
I know, I took the answers away.
I know. So I know what she's asking here, but the response would be...
Soy de
Oklahoma.
¿Dónde vives?
Vivo en Broomfield.
¿Dónde trabajas?
Trabajo en Boulder.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta practicar yoga. El yoga?
You could say practicar el yoga. Mm-hmm.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
Mi número de teléfono es 405-308-8445.
Estamos en contacto.
So for this one, you can respond, me parece bien. Sounds good.
Me parece bien.
Hasta luego.
Ciao.
Good. Okay. Carly de Lea.
Hola. ¿Qué tal?
Tranquilo.
Me llamo Carly. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Lea.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿De dónde eres?
Soy de Denver.
¿Dónde vives?
Vivo en Denver.
¿Dónde trabajas?
Trabajas en mi casa.
Trabajo
en mi casa.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta cocinar. How do you say cooking?
Yeah, cocinar. Mm-hmm.
¿Usted cocina?
You got it.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
Mi número de teléfono es 303-910-5912.
Estamos en contacto.
Me parece bien.
Me parece.
Me parece. Parece. Me parece bien.
Hasta luego.
Nos vemos.
Muy bien, Lea. Ahora, Lea Ascar.
Hola, ¿qué tal?
Todo bien.
Me llamo Lea. Estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar?
Sí, por supuesto.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Me llamo Sky.
Mucho gusto.
Igualmente.
¿De dónde eres?
Soy de Nebraska.
¿De dónde vives?
Vivo en Denver.
¿Dónde trabajas?
Trabajo en Frederick.
¿Qué te gusta?
Me gusta esquiar.
Me gusta
esquiar.
¿Cuál es tu número de teléfono?
Mi número de teléfono es 303-601-9905.
¿Estamos en contacto?
Me parece bien.
Hasta luego.
Ciao.
Okay, nice job with that, everybody. Quick little review of our useful questions. What do these mean in English? ¿Puedo hacer una pregunta?
Ask the question. Can I ask the question?
Can I ask a question? Good. ¿Cómo se dice book?
How do you say book?
¿Qué significa lápiz?
What does pencil mean?
Muy bien. Okay.
What does lápiz mean?
Let's learn some new useful phrases for you. No entiendo. Repiten. No entiendo.
No entiendo.
What does this mean, do you think?
I don't understand.
Perfect. Okay, say it with me again. No entiendo.
No entiendo.
No entiendo.
No entiendo.
No entiendo.
No entiendo.
Bien. I always make my students say this 3 times because honestly, this is your best friend for the next, 1 to 3 months. I like to think that I can teach my students how to speak Spanish in about 3 months, right? To be conversational in most of your daily interactions. But if we're going to be honest with ourselves, to get there, that involves a lot of awkward moments. That's going to involve a lot of moments of like learning how to introduce yourself, right? Hola, me llamo David, estoy estudiando español. ¿Podemos practicar? And then hearing a And so I really want to stress the importance of this phrase, no entiendo, because as adults learning our second language, we tend to do two things when we hear Spanish that we don't understand. The first one is the classic head nod up and down, right? Uh-huh, right? You have no idea what that person just said to you, but you're saying yes. So don't do that, it's not good. Or the second thing that we do as adults is the opposite. Uh-uh. But we just honestly, we don't understand what the person's saying to us. So I really want to stress the importance of memorizing this phrase, no entiendo, and using it a lot, because people will try to help you understand once they recognize you don't really speak a whole lot of Spanish, right? So next one, repite, por favor.
Repite, por favor.
So this means please repeat, of course. And the last one, más despacio, por favor.
Más despacio, por favor.
So what does this one mean?
Slower.
Much slower.
Slower, please. Slower, please. Okay, good. So these phrases kind of go hand in hand. What if I come up to you and I say, yo soy un hombre sincero de donde crece la palma y antes de morirme quiero cantar mis versos del alma. Cultivo una rosa blanca en junio como en enero para el amigo sincero que me da su mano franca. ¿Qué dices? What do you say?
No entiendo.
Yeah, so any of those things might work for you in this situation, right? No entiendo, I don't understand. Repite, por favor. Now, 9 out of 10 times, if you tell somebody to repeat what they just said, they're going to repeat it just the same way, right? So you probably also need to say, repite más despacio. You can combine both of those. Repeat slower, please, right? And then maybe you identify, like maybe you understand some of it, but you don't necessarily understand what La Palma means, right? So if there's just one word that you can kind of identify, you might say, oh, ¿qué significa La Palma? Right? And I would say, oh, La Palma means palm tree. Okay, so try to get in the habit of using these phrases early on in your Spanish speaking career. It will do you wonders in the long run. Carly, ¿cuál es tu música favorita? Mi música favorita.
Mi música favorita es indie.
Indie, okay, la música indie, independiente. Bien. Lea, ¿te gusta la música de Celia Cruz?
Sí, me gusta la música de Celia Cruz.
Bien. Does anybody not know who Celia Cruz is here? Okay, Sky, I had a feeling somebody would say that, right? So if you have, do you have your books yet?
No, it arrives on Sunday. Sorry, I don't have it yet.
Oh, that's okay.
I don't have mine either, yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to share the lyrics with you then here. So yesterday we were kind of talking about this just a little bit. Somebody asked me about podcasts, right? So podcast, you know, anything you can do to immerse yourself in the Spanish language and the Spanish culture, I suppose is a good thing. However, based off of the current level, I think there are some activities that are better than others. So Spanish podcasts, I don't necessarily think are the most productive use of your time just yet, because it's one of those things, until you get 1,000 words memorized, you're just not gonna understand most of what you're hearing. And therefore it's not that good of an activity for you, right? Because you're not actually helping yourself develop your ear, because it doesn't matter how fast or how slow they're speaking. But this is an activity, regardless of your level, that I think is productive to help you develop your ear. And we live in a great time now with YouTube and Google that it's as easy as finding a song in Spanish that you like and looking it up on YouTube and then looking up the lyrics on Google. So that way you can follow along with the lyrics. It's really important, especially initially, that you can read the words so that you can isolate the words that you don't understand and also help kind of like read along as you're listening to it to train your ear to hear it, right? And then because you can read it, you can then isolate those words and look them up online to see what they mean. So it's a powerful activity. So we're gonna listen to a song then by Celia Cruz. And you should be able to see the lyrics here. Can everybody see the Word document I shared?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, so just follow along with the lyrics here.
Thank you.
Sky, ¿te gusta Celia Cruz?
Sí, me gusta.
Muy bien. She's one of my favorite artists. She's no longer with us, but she's kind of considered like the godmother of salsa. She's from Cuba and has a lot of great music. So if you like this song, try and look up Celia Cruz or any other Spanish songs that you might be familiar with. But did you see how we were reading along with the lyrics? And it's kind of very helpful for listening to those words, because chances are most of those words were new words for you, right? Mm-hmm. So, muy bien. By the way, did anybody recognize this passage in that song? So this is actually from a very famous poem by a guy named Jose Martí that wrote a lot about independence when Cuba was kind of thinking about breaking away from Spain. And so that's kind of a little play off of one of his poems that later got turned into one of the greatest kind of folklore songs from Cuba and the Caribbean. Muy bien. Ok, vamos a practicar. Sky, ¿cómo se dice pencil?
Lápiz.
Bien. And if you want to throw in the article going forward, just to kind of help you with the masculine, feminine thing. Carly, ¿cómo se dice pen?
El bolígrafo.
¿Cómo se dice marker?
El marcador.
El marcador.
El marcador.
¿Cómo se dice book?
El libro.
¿Cómo se dice paper?
El papel.
¿Cómo se dice whiteboard?
La pizarra.
Muy bien. So here's just a little review of the dialogue that we learned about buying things, right? So let's start with Leia. You're on the left, and Sky, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuesta el lápiz?
El lápiz cuesta 10 centavos.
Bien. ¿Cuánto cuesta el papel?
El papel cuesta $2.
Llevo el papel y el lápiz.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Muy bien. Okay, so now let's go. Sky, you're on the left. Carly, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuesta un libro, el libro?
El libro cuesta $9.
Bien, ¿cuánto cuesta el lápiz?
El lápiz cuesta 10 centavos.
Y llevo el libro y un lápiz.
Y el lápiz.
Y el lápiz.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Bien. We're going to talk about the word un today. So, but for the time being, let's hold off on using that one. All right, Carly, you're on the left. Leia, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuesta el marcador?
El marcador cuesta $3.
Bien, ¿cuánto cuesta la pizarra?
La pizarra cuesta 10 dólares.
Llevo el marcador y la pizarra.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Next one? Leia, you're on the left, and then Sky, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuesta el bolígrafo?
El bolígrafo cuesta $1.
Un dólar.
Do I ask how much the paper is too?
Mm-hmm. ¿Cuánto cuesta el papel?
El papel cuesta $2.
Llevo el bolígrafo y el papel.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Muy bien. All right. Now, let's imagine if we're getting on a plane and going down to Mexico or Spain or whatever, it's probably unlikely you're going to go shopping for school supplies, right? Mm. So now I want to kind of shift this and put it into more realistic terms, right? So you might want to take turns asking me this question now. ¿Cómo se dice? These are going to be more realistic purchases when you go traveling in the Spanish-speaking world, right? So that first one is gum. So Leia, you can say ¿Cómo se dice gum to me?
¿Cómo se dice gum? Mm-hmm.
Los chicles. And now, Sky?
¿Cómo se dice water?
Mm-hmm. And this one is bottle of water, so it's la botella de agua.
Carly? ¿Cómo se dice pop en español?
El refresco.
¿Cómo se dice beer?
La cerveza.
¿Cómo se dice potato chips?
Las papitas.
Remember
when we learned potato is papa? Mm-hmm. So papita is a play on that word.
¿Cómo se dice candy?
Los caramelos. Okay, muy bien. So let's practice. Carly, you're on the left. Leia, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo está? Oops, sorry. Carly's
That's okay. I was remembering my left and right. Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuestan los chicles?
Los chicles cuestan $3.
Bien, ¿cuánto cuesta la botella de agua?
La botella de agua cuesta $2.
Llevo los chicles y la botella de agua.
Los chicles y la botella.
Los chicles y la botella de agua.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Muy bien. So good. Just to point out, and you actually caught it. So, ¿cuánto cuestan? There's an N here because los chicles is plural. Mm-hmm. So it's the difference between how much do they cost versus how much does it cost. All right, let's go. Leia, you're on the left now. Sky, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuestan el caramelos?
Los caramelos here.
Los caramelos cuestan $7.
Bien, ¿cuánto cuesta? I forgot this one, sorry.
El refresco. Sounds like refreshment. It's really soda, but it's, or pop, but it sounds like refreshments.
Or fresco. Isn't there a soda named Fresco or Fresca?
There might be. I'm not 100% sure. That sounds familiar.
Bien. ¿Cuánto cuesta el refresco?
El refresco cuestan... 4 dólares.
Llevo los caramelos y el refresco.
Gracias, chao.
Nos vemos.
Muy Muy bien. Sky, you're on the left. Carly, you're on the right.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Estoy bien, gracias. ¿Cuánto cuesta
la cerveza? With an A on the end. ¿Cuánto cuesta?
¿Cuánto cuesta la cerveza?
La cerveza cuesta $6.
Bien. ¿Cuánto cuestan las papitas?
Las papitas cuestan $5.
Llevo las cervezas y la cerveza y las papitas.
Gracias. Chao.
Nos vemos.
Okay, nice job with that. So talking about things that we like, of course, we could say te gusta, right? Te gusta la motocicleta. If we want to add a little more detail or a follow-up question here, we might say something like, do you prefer the car or the motorcycle? So in Spanish, you would say prefieres, do you prefer, prefieres. Notice here, the direct way to answer this would be to change this ES ending over to an O, right? So this ES means you, this O means I. So you could say prefiero el carro, or me gusta más el carro, which is like saying I like the car more, or me gusta menos la motocicleta, I like the motorcycle less. Bien. Sky, ¿te gusta la motocicleta?
No me gusta la motocicleta.
¿Prefieres el carro o la motocicleta?
Prefiero el carro.
Muy bien. Sky to Carly.
¿Te gusta el verano?
Sí, me gusta el verano.
¿Qué estación prefieres?
Prefiero el verano.
Carly Alea.
¿Te gusta la música salsa?
Sí, me gusta la música salsa.
¿Qué música prefieres?
Prefieres. Prefiero rock. El rock. ¿Te gusta leer?
Sí, me gusta leer.
¿Qué tipo de libro preferes?
All right, so isolate those vowels, right? And this is actually a good thing.
Prefieres.
Good, right? So we have an A. E, A, A. If you're struggling with it, it's because it's not a normal sound for our American mouth to make.
It's so similar in French and Italian, I get it.
I know that's another thing that's throwing you off, especially Leia, right? But anytime you have a word like that, just to isolate those vowels, because in Spanish we pronounce every single vowel. A-E-A-A. Prefieres.
Prefieres.
Muy bien.
¿Qué tipo de libro prefieres?
Prefiero biografía.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, in Spanish, if we're talking about plural things that we like, we have to add an N to the verb gusta. So I like things as me gustan, with an an on the end, okay? Can you read these examples to us, Carly?
Me gustan las clases de español. Me gustan los partidos de fútbol. Me gustan los tacos.
Oh, yeah. All right, so if we're gonna say you like, we just changed me to te. Can you read these examples, Leah?
¿Te gustan las clases de español? ¿Te gustan los partidos de fútbol? ¿Te gustan los tacos?
Very good. And then just last one, right? If we're asking a question, it's te gustan. So let's practice first here. Sky, would you say me gusta el tigre o me gustan el tigre?
Me gusta el tigre.
Carly?
Me gustan los perros.
Lea?
Me gustan los gatos.
Me gusta el pájaro.
Me gusta el pez.
Me gustan los caballos.
Caballos.
Me gustan los tacos.
Me gusta la cerveza.
Me gusta el mojito.
Me gusta el vino.
Me gustan los refrescos.
Okay, so let's take turns asking each other these questions. Carly to Leah, take both questions on the slide.
¿Te gusta la pizza?
Sí, me gusta la pizza.
¿Te gustan los animales?
Sí, me gustan los animales. ¿Te gustan películas cómicas?
Sí, me gustan las películas cómicas.
¿Te gusta la música de Celia Cruz?
Sí, me gusta la música de Celia Cruz. ¿Cuál es tu actividad favorita?
Mi actividad favorita es practicar yoga.
¿Cuál es tu animal favorito?
Mi animal favorito es perro. ¿Cuál es tu país favorito?
País
favorito.
Mi país favorito es España.
¿Cuál es tu música favorita?
Mi música favorito es favorita es rock.
Yeah, this will probably be the last thing we get to today. We'll talk about adjectives a little bit. There's a few things that we need to know about adjectives. They work differently from Spanish to English. The first difference is that they're backwards. So just go back to our third grade grammar class. An adjective is a descriptive word, if you're not familiar with that term, right? So we just use this word to describe something else. In English, we put it before the word that we describe. In Spanish, it usually follows the word it describes. So if I wanted to say he is a short boy, I would actually have to say he is a boy short, right? So Spanish, no big deal. You just have to think backwards. Okay, so that would be él es un niño bajo. Muy bien. The next thing you have to know about adjectives is that they have to match the word that they describe in both number and in gender. So what that means is if I'm describing a boy, it would be el niño bajo. And if I'm describing a girl, it'd be la niña baja. So notice the article changes from el to la, the noun changes from niño to niña, and the adjective changes from bajo to baja. Just like nouns that end with E don't change, adjectives don't typically change either. Most words that end with E would be like unisex or neutral words, right? So el carro grande, la motocicleta grande. So carro is masculine, as we can definitely confirm with the article el. Motocicleta is feminine, which is confirmed with our article la, but notice that grande is grande. Again, ojo, usually, right? There's a few exceptions to this. Now, they have to match in number as well, as I mentioned, right? So el hombre alto means the tall man. If I wanted to say the tall men, I would say los hombres altos. So notice I change el to los, hombre to hombres, and add an S to alto. Alto changes to altos, okay? So you'd add an S if it ends with a vowel, and if it ends with a consonant, you add ES to make the adjective plural. La flor azul is the blue flower. Las flores azules would be the blue flowers. Does that make sense to everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Muy bien. So Carly, how could you say the big dog and the small dog?
El perro grande.
El
perro. No sé.
Okay, the small is chico.
Chico.
Okay. Leah, how could you say the big dogs? Actually, let's continue with Carly. So Carly, how would you say the big dogs?
Los perros grande.
Grandes.
Grandes.
So making sure you're adding the S to grande as well. And then the small dogs.
Los perros chicos.
Muy bien. Okay, Leia.
La manzana grande or chico, this little one. Chica, la manzana chica, la manzana grande.
Muy bien.
Las manzana grande.
So you got the last part right, but you need to make all the other words plural as well.
Las manzanas grandes.
There you go, perfect.
Las mañanas chicas.
That would be the small mornings. Manzanas.
Las manzanas chicas.
Okay. Muy bien. All right. Vamos con Sky.
El gato chico. Y el gato.
Here we're with now beautiful and ugly. So we've got el gato bonito.
Oh, that's el gato bonito. El gato feo. Los gatos bonitos. Las gatos feos.
Okay, so it's
Los gatos feos.
Yeah.
Is this mine too?
Carly.
Okay. Oh. El caro bonita o rico.
Here we're going for new and old.
New. El caro, ¿cómo se dice new en español?
Nuevo.
Nuevo. And then el caro es old. Old en español. Viejo. Viejo.
And then plural?
Los caros nuevos. Los caros viejos.
El relevo.
Relo. Relo.
El relo caro.
Caro. Also with an O on the end. Caro.
El relo caro. El relo barato.
Barato. Barato.
Barato. El reloj, all right, so las relojes caros.
Los relojes caros.
Los relojes caros. Los relojes baratos.
El hombre rico y el hombre pobre. Los hombres ricos. Los hombres pobres.
La estudiante, and then what are we looking at
here? We're looking for good, bad.
Okay. La estudiante buena. Buena.
Buena, muy bien.
La estudiante mal.
Mala.
Mala. Mala. Los estudiantes buenos. Los estudiantes malos.